Are you guys flowing? How's the flow? I'm going to talk to you about flowing in the Holy Ghost tonight. And, you know, it's a really good way to start. It's just, how is the flow right now? Everybody in this place has been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. And you know that sometimes that flow's just not there. Huh? You shouldn't know that, but you know that. I'm just tricking you, okay? Okay. But yeah, you know, and especially if you've been hollering and screaming at somebody, huh? Or you all discouraged and disappointed. Are you with me?
Yes.
But if you'll just get in the flow, if you'll learn how to stay in the flow, hallelujah. We'll change the discouraging situations. It'll keep you from screaming and hollering. You'll calm down. Just take care of my night. Don't have to count to 10 backwards or whatever they do. Huh? And so I want to just talk to you about how to move in with the flow, whether you're praying, singing, preaching. All of these things are understood with respect to how you flow in the Holy Ghost, just in your personal relationship. If you just try to think real hard and get all upset and desperate and self-conscious about trying to prophesy, it ain't nothing gonna happen. And whatever happens, it's gonna be weird. Are you with me? Ain't nobody gonna like it. So, how about Can you do that to the place where you lose the ability almost to speak in English? Just get so kato ramo shea pa le main de pro shea putorushi. Can you dana mosebi? I personally believe that's like where you're right on the verge of just doing everything else in the Holy Ghost, especially the interpretation of tongues. It's such a flow. It's so, the flow, what is the flow? It's effortless, isn't it? You understand what I'm saying? It's just the float. The flow is a float, right? It's just effortless. And not only is it effortless, there's a whole lot of peace there. There's a whole lot of relaxing there. There's a whole lot of comfort there. You don't feel awkward. I tell you what, when the enemy, well, it doesn't really even take the enemy. I was going to say, when the enemy or so will come out against you, try to hinder you, you could almost feel a little bit awkward. But it didn't even take that. You can just be so caught away in your own thinking and your own concern about yourself that you feel awkward. That sense of self-consciousness sometimes is removed out of the way when you become accustomed to speaking in front of people. Let's just talk about standing up in English class and giving a report on the date, the first time your tooth fell out or something, some weird, awkward thing, right? Right? It just doesn't work. You just don't feel like getting up in front of people. Now, let's take your person that's, you're really shy, you know, you're not very outgoing, somewhat timid, okay, and even worse, introverted, and now you got to stand up in front of everybody. What's the problem here? You know, the problem is that the self-consciousness so overwhelms you that you basically are feeling like you're going to die on the inside because everybody's staring at you. That is not the flow. Am I helping you? That is not the flow. You know, let me kind of give you some other examples. When you're really well prepared for something, let's just say you've learned something, you know it well, you've rehearsed it well, whether it's a piano recital, instrument recital, a speech that you got to give, a presentation that you got to give, that helps to relax you, right? And it helps to do something else. It makes you confident, right? Or bold, right? And you can go with it. And then, of course, if you've done it more than once, you become even more confident and even more bold, right? Okay. Everybody's with me?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So you could say that that's certainly not the flow that I'm talking about, and that can easily be mistaken for what I'm talking about, okay? People very good at speaking, very confident with themselves. You know, they don't have really any sense of let me just throw that word out there, inferiority or fear. That could be mistaken for a flow. And you see, some people just got an amazing gift of gab. You know what I'm saying? They just like, they just go on and on and on. And it doesn't matter, you know, who they're talking to. And there's folks like my mother, never met a stranger. She can walk up to the ugliest person, scariest looking person on the face of the earth, smiling there, talking like she's known him since she was, you know, 6 years old or whatever. So there's certain dimensions of human nature that allow people to have a little bit more confidence around others and not be intimidated or not have the fear or not have those things that otherwise would cause them to be all self-conscious and stumbling up over every tooth in their mouth, so to speak, and not really able to communicate what they feel or what they're thinking or what needs to be said. And the one thing that I want to be able to isolate for you when I start talking about the flow, I want to isolate for you what it means to have this great confidence and boldness in the Holy Ghost, where it really goes beyond something that you've rehearsed and beyond something that you know and beyond something that you've thought through. You're just, I mean, the only reason a drunk person has any right to be confident and bold and not self-conscious is because they're basically out of their mind. Are you with me?
Yeah.
They're not thinking right. All of that doesn't matter anymore, okay? But what happens when you get, when you get sutaraba sitele mekaturibohuro, sutaradeya putoro no seya, so caught up in praise, so caught up in worship? I'll stop there for just a second and make a point. A lot of the men and women of God who are apt at flowing in prophecy, apt at flowing in ministry, and whether it's the speaking gifts or whether it's the revelatory gifts, like the revelatory gifts, you know what I mean by when I say a revelatory gifts, right? The word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the discerning spirits, which is something, especially when it comes to the word of knowledge, I'm really pressing in and allowing the Lord to teach me about how a tangible, clear, open vision is associated with the word of knowledge. And I'm not saying that academically. I'm talking about spiritually, okay? I mean, where that, and this is going to sound a little strange for you, but at the expense of just going ahead and trying to bring you along in this, I mean, where you close your eyes, literally, you close your eyes, and it's not an imagination, but it's like you turn on the TV. It's that clear. It's that real. Listen, really, I'm not kidding you. Now, you give yourself to that. I'm not talking about strong imagination. I'm not talking about doing it outside of this intimacy, the flow. Once again, people try to do things and have things in the gifting of the Spirit, isolated from the flow of the Holy Ghost, that ain't gonna work out for you, okay? But when you really believe in this, I really believe in this, this isn't fictional to me. This isn't something that everybody else can have but me. This is a giftings that God has available for those who are really earnest about applying themselves to it and going after it. I mean, I'm talking about, listen, at least applying yourself on the level that you would apply yourself to manage your checkbook. Are you listening to me? And then how about if all of a sudden you begin to apply it on the level that you were going to go get a degree? Huh? And maybe some of you don't understand that. When you're, depending on, it, now if you're in high school, you don't have to study. But you get into college, well, some people have to study. I don't want to act like that nobody has to study. But I'm just say that some people don't have to study in high school. But you get to college and you're going to have to study a little bit. And you go to graduate school and you're going to study a lot. Okay? Because now it isn't what you've already learned, just coming at you in a different way. Okay? Now it's new information. Well, what happens really, we're saying, oh God, I'm so hungry for you. God, I want to just be so used. I want to step over into this realm of your glory. And then he looks at us and watches us. You know, look at what you're doing to get your money, man. Look at what you're doing to get your reputation. Look, God sees. He knows. He's, come on. You know what I'm saying? He loves us like our mom, but he's not playing any games. You understand what I'm saying? You know, mom thought everything we did was cute. Hey, look, mom, I can stand on one foot or whatever. Right? That's amazing. Right? But come on. Can you understand what I'm saying? I think that we think that the Lord's amazed that we stand on one foot. Look, I'm one foot. Look, I can blink. We want to see me roll on the floor. He's not impressed. He loves us, but he's not impressed with it. We have to, you know, we have to really deal with the reality of how much time we actually go after wanting to step in and flow in these things and operate in these things in the spirit. Because Father evaluates, you know, like I said on Wednesday night, imagine that you have a scale in front of you and every hour is a 1 gram weight. Okay, and now you're going to have on one side is what you're doing for you, and on the other side is what you're doing for the Lord. At the end of the day, is the scale balanced? Whose favor is it tipped in? Hello. And then somebody says, yeah, that's right. I just can't spend time with the Lord. That's why I'm just such an idiot or whatever. Don't do that. That's why I can't flow and operate God. Really? Then yeah, you're never going to do nothing. With an attitude like that, you know what? I'm amazed you're going to make heaven. I'd be amazed to see you there. Because that really shouldn't even exist. Are you with me? Am I making my point? Because there's so many people just give up, throw the towel in. They're beat before they start. No, I'm talking about hunger and thirsting over here. Hello. I'm not talking about, I've already eaten. I don't need anything. Are you with me? Are you listening to me? I'm not thirsty. I've already had something to drink. I'm talking about you haven't eaten for days. You know, I'm waiting on the Lord for giving me strength because I'm considering going on a fast at the beginning of the year. Okay? I know what that's like. I get extremely hungry. And it hurts. Anybody in here fast? Most of you don't look like it. But it hurts. And that's a big part of the reason we don't do it. Somebody said, why should we fast anyways? Because you got a lot of hindrances. You don't have to fast to get God to do anything. He's happy to do it. He's giving it. You got a lot of hindrances in receiving. Fast breaks hindrances. It does things with hindrances. Did something for Daniel, right?
Yes, it did.
There was a hindrance. Fasted, what happened? Huh? Hindrance in prayer. Hindrance in casting out devil. Well, I must do it fast. Because there's a problem with your flow. Is really what he's talking about. There's a problem with your flow. Fasting helps you flow. But I mean, it's just you get so hungry. That's what we're talking about here. If you want to move in and get the spirit, you have to be so hungry. Well, how do I develop a spiritual hunger? By eating. Because you can be so spiritually dead, you just can't even take anything. People just about dead, you can't hardly give them even a spoonful of soup. You know what I'm saying? It's too weak. And even though that's a bad analogy, it still will serve the purpose, okay? Can you turn me up just a little bit? Because spiritual hunger, participating in the things of the Spirit, just by itself, no matter where you're at in terms of how hungry or thirsty you are, it makes you more hungry. Huh? It is an amazing deterrent for sin, too. And wanting to be satisfied with other things. He's just like, I want this glory realm. I want this peace realm. I want this love realm, this joy realm. Every dimension of flowing in the Holy Ghost always produces that. So try to go back real quickly to what I was saying just a minute ago. And just really just emphasize the point of hunger and thirsting. Emphasizing the point of you got to give yourself to these things. And if you're really, really hungry, it's not going to be, oh, well, I just really don't have time. I guarantee you get hungry, you're going to find yourself. Everything tastes good. One of the times Ann and I were fasting, it was fasting together, and we broke our fast after 2 hours. No, I'm just kidding. We broke our fast after 3 days. You know, we went to the Sonic in Texas, the nasty Sonic. Right? we got there, and those were like, whoa, these are the best onion rings we've ever had in our life. And we never even knew about this place. We never even knew it. Amazing. These are like the best onion rings in the world. We go back the next day, and it's like, but we were hungry. We were so hungry. It's just like, whoa, we haven't eaten for 3 days. This is amazing. That's what the Lord, when he's talking to us about those things that he wants to give us and how we're going to receive them, he uses those desperate appetites. So, I mean, of course, thirst, my goodness, there's nothing. There's nothing compares to thirst. Any of you, have any of you been really thirsty lately? I know it's a modern society. It's like, you know, and then everybody works in the office and, you know, they've been drinking everything you can possibly think of by noon. No, I mean, just to really get thirsty. I practiced this for a while because I think you should experiment. If you really want, I really want to understand. If you say, I really want to understand, what does this mean? What does this mean? How can I touch this? I mean, I used to go out into the desert and go without water to try to get it. I mean, I didn't go too long. You can't go too long. But I did a day. And just imagine Moses going 40 days without water. Try a day in the hot sun in the desert. Thirsty. And now you're thirsty. You're thirsty, right? You've been all day in the desert, fasting, no food, no water. So no moisture from anything. And now it's night, and you've said to yourself, you can drink, but you won't let yourself drink. You're like just kind of like dealing with this thirsty thing. Somebody says, you're weird. No, I'm touching it. I want to understand it. Well, I want to get it better. I'm so thirsty. I'm craving it. I've got to have it. It's not a law. Huh? I don't have to. I desperately want to. And it's where need becomes a desperate desire. You have to think about that for a while because you can't get that semantically. You can't get that just listen to verbiage. I'm still talking about the flow. Really, I am. Yeah. Yeah. Whew, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm talking about something that develops out of the friendship with the Lord, out of the relationship with the Lord. So you're never going to have an attitude when there's true hunger and spiritual thirsting that you've allowed to develop. And if you don't have it, let God develop it in you. Don't just act like it doesn't matter. Try that with food, please. Start January 1st. Let me know when you stop. Please. Just try it. Oh, it doesn't matter. I don't really have time for food anyways. Never have time to sit down and eat. We're so busy. We don't have time to sit down and eat. We're so busy, we don't have time to get something to drink. Try that. Let me know when you quit. Am I making my point?
Yes.
I mean, this cross you. I feel like I kind of am. I don't feel like I really am. But I kind of am. Because we'll make things, we won't apply things. Psychologically, our brain will play tricks on us, and we won't let them, these things sink in. We'll act like we already understand that. So, you know, I did it in school. You did it in school. The teacher went under the chalkboard. They solved that equation so quick. You're like, wow, that's easy. I don't even need to study that for the test. That's easy, right? I don't even need to take notes. That's so easy. Huh? You get home, you can't even, you try a practice problem and you're like stuck. Why? Because you thought you knew it. You thought you understood, right? Everybody's had that deception, haven't you?
Yeah.
Okay. It happens right here too. Happens all the time. It's like, oh, I got that. That's easy. I mean, no problem. Simple. Okay. Well, then let's bring it. Hallelujah. Bring that interpretation of tongue. Bring that word of knowledge. Bring that which God the Holy Ghost has supplied freely. I mean, we as a church, I want to be able to just, you know, point at you and look at you and say, come here and tell us. See, when I see the anointing on you, I see that it happens all the time. I see the anointing on some people, and I used to make the mistake in the past, but I don't anymore. See the anointing on somebody, I say, hey, come here, and immediately the anointing's gone. Are you with me?
Yeah.
They were just receiving from heaven just as a flow. And as soon as I said, here, come here, I want you to share. Now, what's happening? What? You know, panic sets in. You're going to do what? You want me to do what? What am I supposed to talk about? That we don't want you to, we don't want you to think about what we're supposed to talk about. We just want you to come up here and stand in what you now are sitting there experiencing. And as you do, something will happen to you. That's the flow. It's developed out of your relationship with the Lord. Brother Yun, I think is it going to be with us in March or May? I think it's March. But at any rate, I really wanted him to come for a number of days. I didn't want to come rushing in, rushing out, have the handlers pushing him through the door. I wanted to be able to come. I'm still working on trying to get this. Come, chill out. Let us take care of you. Let's do some Chinese meetings so you can see Brother Yun in the flow. Because you don't get to really see him in the flow. That's not the flow. Really, when people see him, that's not the flow. That's the job. I don't do the job. I don't know if anybody ever noticed, I don't do the job. I do the flow. I do the flow. I do the Holy Ghost flow. I do the flow. This is what's fun. This is where we get to start moving around in the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. So that's all comes out of that flow is developed where you're able to go there deeper and you just have fun. You don't have any restraint. It's not a professionalism. It's not a confidence over time. Because I go to a place where I've never been before and that flow is just there. It's just there. There's this confidence there. There's a boldness there. Because it's an overshadowing glory of heaven that comes upon us. So, you know, I used to describe it like this. It's being alone with God in a public place. And I still describe it that way. I still like that. Being alone with God in a public place. What if you're never alone with God in a private place? Whoops, you got a problem, right? Because that flow is out of that. So if I could get Brother Yin to come for a while, and he'd spend some time getting the flow. You spend some time, get, you know, just be relaxed, just no, not be under the gun for time, pressure for time. You'd see him go somewhere that he has in his relationship with the Lord. You'd see him step over in a flow, and when he does, everything begins to change in the way that he ministers. It becomes more refreshing. The atmosphere begins to change. And when Brother Yun gets over in that realm, and I've been with him a number of times in this, and I'm just pointing him out. I could talk about other people. He'll fall down on his knees and he'll start singing psalms. And when he does, he's got his eyes closed, he's down on his knees, usually his hands are lifted up. He's singing psalms. I mean, the room becomes charged with the presence of the Lord. What is that? That's the flow that was developed in his relationship with the Lord in prison cells. Hello, are you with me? Tough place to develop a relationship. Now, I'm not saying that's the only dimension. There'll be other, let's take Carlos Anacondia. There's certain songs that he wants done for the flow. And there's certain people he wants singing them because of the particular anointing in their life or gifting in their life of where they've been around him for a long time and he's able to hook up with it and he rides upon that flow and then he can step right over into the operation of the Holy Ghost through his life. Because really, we're talking about the flow. We're talking about the operation of the Holy Spirit through our lives. We're not talking about human effort. We're not talking about our human skill. We're not talking about our human ability. That's why people who don't really have a lot sometimes are able to go much deeper with God because there is a greater dependency. They can't substitute. They can't kind of whitewash the thing. You know, I don't have a flow right now, but you know what? I got enough Bible knowledge. I can fill in the blanks, fill in the spaces. I can wing it, huh? Shoot from the hip and wing it. But you hear what I'm saying? Yes. I hope you can hear what I'm saying. Yes. So, it doesn't have to It doesn't have to be that way. But I'm going to tell you right now. Now, we didn't worship before I started ministering. But I'm ministering to you out of the realms of the flow. Could the flow come stronger? Absolutely. But I'm ministering to you out of the flow. I'm not here concerned. I'm not worried. I'm not fretting about the next thing I'm going to say. Really don't even know what the next thing is I'm going to say. I'm just describing to you those things that the Lord is making real to me as I speak. But I give myself to worship. I love to give myself to worship. What's going to happen is the deeper I hook up in worship, when I start speaking, I'll prophesy. You'll notice it. If you see me dancing around, caught away, I'm just like, he's gone. He's gone. I mean, anybody that can do that on a platform has got to be somewhere else, kind of thing, you know. He definitely is no zero, zero measurable self-consciousness, right? Zero measured intimidation or concern about what other people think. When I come out of that, I'll just start prophesying. I'll just prophesy. It'll be a flow. It'll be just a radical, usually a radical, authoritative flow that's cleaning the atmosphere of all the stuff that hinders. Did you know that you've had a whole bunch of stuff hindering you today? Yeah. Amen. Did you know that that's not what the Lord wants for your life?
Yes.
Do you know that that's what you allow?
Yes.
Do you know it's based upon your own spiritual need for growth? And you won't have any hindrances no more. So therefore, depending on where we're going at in the meeting and how big the manifestation and power, the glory of God is going to be, those hindrances are going to have to be dealt with. Especially, look at with respect to Jesus. He could not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. It's a hindrance. It's a hindrance. It's a hindrance to what? The flow. The flow of the Spirit. God, the Holy Ghost, the flow of the Spirit. God, the moving of the Holy Ghost is talked in terms of and related to us in the Word of God in terms of a flow. The prophet says, bring me someone who's good on a musical instrument and I'll prophesy. He's going to get into the flow. The Lord says, out of your belly flows rivers of living water, the spekia of the Holy Ghost. This realm of divine glory. Here's a sad thing. Is people just want to think they can turn on the toggle switch and just flip on the switch. Oh, well, I'm going to church tonight. Bless your heart. I'm glad you came. I'm glad you're so faithful. Now why don't you start getting yourself over into a realm of a flow. And instead of saying, well, you know, I'm running late, but I'm going to go to church anyways and no, I'm not ready. Why would you ever be in a state where you're not ready? Why don't you take that statement, that disposition, and tell yourself, wait a minute, I'm not doing this anymore. Living in the flow. I'm going to have some kind of measurable response factors of how I live in the flow, how I function flow. Now, you know, there are so many dynamics to this flow that I'm trying to hit as many of them as I can, only on the major points. And and reality of it is, if I look at all the various different things that are there that would stop us or hinder us, places of not being prepared, just not understanding how to participate with God, it could become very confusing. You know, you'd have to have a whole notebook full of notes and go over them before you even, you know, started talking to the Lord. But it's not that difficult. I'm just trying to help you understand why it seems to be so difficult. I'm trying to help you understand why you don't do it. You say, well, I do it when no one's looking. It don't count when no one's looking. You can be the most brilliant person on the face of the earth, and if you can't communicate what you know, you're as big as an idiot as the worst idiot on the face of the earth. I'm using crude language, but do you understand what I'm telling you? Oh, you don't know, man. You should see me when I'm away and alone with God. I mean, thunder's coming out of heaven, lightning striking everything, power of God's moving. You got yourself a wild imagination is what you got. Because reality of it is what you are in secret. God amplifies it in public. Hallelujah. Seek me in secret. You know, that's what the Word says. I reward you what?
Openly.
openly. That's right. And so don't tell me about them and what you're doing when God's already told me how it's going to work out. Huh? So we want to be able to move you past all those hindrances, you know, which is really most of those hindrances are in the realms of fear. You get to, whether it's self-consciousness or intimidation or sense of condemnation or, you know, you're just not ready or you're just not fit or you're just not something. No, if you could just have within your life a measurable way of which you know where, that you know where you are at in terms of how you are cooperating with the Holy Ghost. Huh? You know what I'm saying? Do you have a measurable way, an indicator? Hallelujah. Huh? If you open up your mouth, if you begin to speak in, you know, you open your mouth and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost and it sounds something like or less, doesn't even have that kind of a flow. It's like blah, 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 blah. You know that you're not in the flow, right? Are you with me? If it's gushing out of you, it's just busting out of you where it can't be stopped. You got yourself flow. Well, the Spirit of the Lord said, why don't you continually build up yourself? The Spirit of the Lord said, why don't you continually be filled? Hallelujah. Where I'm participating with the Holy Ghost. And it's all about flow. Huh? When you go to prayer, you go to prayer and you say, somebody said, Daniel, will you please play? Will you please pray? And you go, you stand up and you go, Lord, God, Father, we're asking, Father in Jesus' name, God, Father, Jesus. You don't have a flow or something to that effect. And how many times have you found yourself doing that? Huh? I haven't found myself doing that at all. But there was a day. And if you find yourself doing that, you got yourself a problem. You won't get that fixed. Huh? And the only way to get that fixed is to do what? Start praying. Start talking to Father in private. Start getting yourself a prayer time. And it'll change all of that. A relationship will produce a flow. Now, there's something that can shut that down. You got yourself a flow. You got yourself a relationship when you're in secret, but you've never known how to stop or deal with those hindrances of self-consciousness coming at you. Those hindrances of fear, those hindrances of disappointment, discouragement, whatever that comes at you. It's just about you. Just about you. Some things that you just need to grow in spiritually. Well, there is a realm of being baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire that deals with that. And all you need to be able to do is learn how to get to grab hold of that in a public place. I was in a meeting one night, some really, you know, well-preppy, you know, preacher. Every hair was in place, and he was like all decked out, jewels and... And he was sitting about, it was a pretty big place, packed up. He was sitting about 10 rows back. Suddenly, the fire of God hit this preacher. He began to tear off his jacket, his tie, his jewels, everything. Started crawling over top of people, over top of the chairs, over top of people, walking on people to get to the altar. He forgot where he was at. He needed that. Sorry for all the people that got trampled. I'm sure somebody inherited a couple of diamond rings out of the program, unless they came back to, I'm sure they did. But the tie went off, the jacket went off. I mean, all the stuff that he lived confined in that stopped him, really, in many respects. I just thought that was a very overt way of watching a demonstration of all of the layers, as it were, that keeps a person from moving with God being dismantled. And that's just some of them. I want to just talk to you. I want to bring you into a place of just talking to you about the flow, but I can't because the reason I can is because it's just too simple. And then you won't understand what your problem is. So I've got to just basically put all the issues up here that you're confronting with, the things that you're not doing are really basic things. It's relationship things. It's relationship with the Lord. It's time at this interaction with Him. It's allowing those things which you've been given by the Holy Spirit to literally be fully utilized by yourself. You don't take it for granted. I mean, Paul said, the grace that was given unto me was not in vain. I labored more than everybody, but it wasn't me. It was the grace that it was at work. Now let's think about it. What you do right now, what you have right now, let's just take, for example, the language of the Spirit. That's the grace of God gave you that. Now, is it in vain? Is it in vain? How precious is it to you? How valuable is it to you? Do you look then just like, well, I've got this amazing gift from God. This is amazing. I need to find out more about it. So I'm going to do a word search because I don't know the Bible very well. I'm going to do a word search and I'm going to go look up everything about the language of the Spirit in the Bible so that I can really begin to understand what I'm supposed to be doing with this, what's supposed to be happening in my life, what are the do's and the don'ts, what is God encouraging me to do? I just squint. I'm so hungry. I'm so happy. I'm so blessed. It's so valuable. It's so sacred. It's so beautiful. That doesn't always happen. And maybe it does at first, but then all of a sudden it becomes commonplace. People start taking the, did you know that it's a very easy thing to do to start taking the most precious and sacred things that you have been given for granted? Did you notice that? Anybody notice that besides me?
Yes.
Okay. Huh? I know wives that notice that about their husbands. I notice husbands that notice that about their wives, you know. Well, Father notices it. Holy Ghost notices it.
Yes.
Father's very impacted by the time that he's impacted by the time you're willing to spend talking to him and interact with him. Because you're not going to talk to him and interact with him in the realms of what, you know, the culture and the earthly, you know, system has imposed upon you. You're going to, if you're going to interact with him, you're going to come over into a place that is purely a heavenly and a spiritual realm. And it's things like his word, and it's things like prayer, and it's things like praise, and it's something that is done in a realm, and it should always start there and truly it does indeed mature of where you know he's right there. And that he's hearing, and that you're interacting with him. How simple can that be? Well, that's where the flow is. That's where you begin to develop in an interaction with the Holy Spirit, because now what you're doing is you're giving permission to the Holy Ghost to be activated in your life and to express through you the Spirit of the Son. You're giving the Spirit of the Lord the permission, as it were. You're yielding your members, your being to him, so that now he can do what it is that without him we would never have been able to do, and why he's come to live on the inside of us. God does not receive praise from any man. You can't worship God without the Holy Ghost. In other words, you can't praise him, you can't worship him, you can't give thanks to him without the Spirit of truth. This is why the Father said, this is why Jesus said, the Father's searching or looking for those who would worship him in spirit and truth. He says, listen, I'll give you a drink and there will be a supply on the inside of you that will cause a flow. Eh?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So that we're a flow that nothing physical or natural or circumstantial can mess with. Where it can be the total worst possible situation, and you're smiling and you're laughing, and it's not, oh, I gotta laugh my way through this. It's not some conscious thing that you are trying to produce out of your own spirit and out of your own you know, emotional inspiration, think good thoughts, happy thoughts. You know, one guy was talking about how when he gets in a troubling situation, I'm not kidding you, preacher, he gets in a troubling situation, he opens up his briefcase, and in his briefcase, he's got several different types of candles with various different smells. And he'll pull out one and he'll start smelling it. And then he's got other paraphernalia. I mean, this guy's getting high, man. You know what I'm saying? He's just tripping on stuff. This is like in his briefcase. Man, by the time he got finished with this, I'm going, I never want to hear you preach. I don't want anything that comes out of the inspiration of the smell of a candle and some kind of lighting that you got going on in your little briefcase world, man. I'm kidding, you're not. But then you had to step back and go, wait, do I do any of those things? Do I have any things like that? When I go shopping or eat chocolate or whatever, you know, who knows? Chocolate anointing, shopping anointing. No, the reality of it is there is an inspiration that comes out of the realms of the Spirit of the Son, out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. All we've got to do is learn how to participate with Him, and the flow is right there. Jesus used the simplest words and the simplest description for the flow. Take a drink. Whoa, take a drink. What on earth does that mean? Where is it? Take a drink. Well, I would take a drink. I would take a drink if you were here and handed it to me. You're missing it. You're missing what he's saying. He's talking about a relationship. He's talking about a fellowship that comes as a result of you being born of the Spirit. It's something that is available that is as easy as taking a drink. Well, then you're looking at me going, well, why is it so hard? What's the difficulty? Time a task. And it's not a task. Because a relationship of love isn't a task. Huh? A desire. A spiritual thirst. You say, I want spiritual thirst. Ask God the Holy Ghost. He'll give you spiritual thirst. It's part of the package. Lord, I want some spiritual thirst. Could you please give me some spiritual thirst? You wait 3 seconds, nothing happens. You go, okay, well, forget about that. You give McDonald's more time than that. And definitely give In-N-Out Burger more time than that. Huh? Little David, we call David, knee case, plays guitar, Little David. Just one of the things. Junior. He was a little guy. He came and prayed for his mom. His mom wasn't feeling well. He came and prayed for his mom. He said, Lord Jesus, I ask you to heal her right now. Amen. He looked at his mom. He said, do you feel better? And she just kind of groaned. He said, call the doctor. Okay, we're going to have to give the Lord a little bit more time than that.
Amen.
We're going to have to give response time in our life. In these things, the developmental time in our life. You can come up to me anytime you want and say, hey, does my tongue sound like tinkling cymbals and sound of brass tea? I'll say, let me hear it again. I'll let you know. So long as I know that you're not going to be crushed for the rest of your life because I told you the truth. And that it's not going to result in you just, I'm just giving up. I can't do anything right. I've been trying for 50 years. I still haven't got it right. Yeah, you are pretty bad off. You've been trying that long. Nothing's working. But it ain't God's fault because he doesn't do it that way. But what we don't get is that it's our fault. Oh, I know it's just my fault. No. You don't really get it because that's a self-defense mechanism. Pastoring as many years as I have, I've seen all these reactions. Okay, I know exactly where it comes from. I know exactly. It's actually a manifestation of the problem. It actually is a declaration of why you're not moving forward. Huh? Hallelujah. If you could just get this, it would be cause for the heavenly choir to break out into the hallelujah song. Amen. Hallelujah. Woo, the flow. I got the flow right here. This is the flow. Hallelujah. Sapaya na sambukaya. Is a burana yambugi ba today. Isabel Tata, proof of it. Now, there are times, and I will get in the car on our way to church, and I may have been doing something. I may have been in the, may have been flowing in prayer, doing something, you know, in the kingdom, whatever, right in the flow, but then get distracted and have to like fix something or, you know, spend my time, you know, pulling something out of the ditch, whatever. And now we're going to hop in the car to go to church. Are you with me? Everybody's here.
Yeah.
Okay. And so what we do is when I get in the car, I start up the car and I stay parada, that's the way it works for me. I'm preparing myself. For what? The flow. And so there's times then that I start in the car and it's like, you know, it's like it's not coming out very good. The flow isn't there like I want it to be, like God wants it to be, like I have to have it to be, like I need it to be, like I'm dependent on it to be, because I haven't trained myself to minister any other way, by song, by preaching, by prophesying, by anything. I'm totally dependent upon God. Now that right there is so absolutely essential to the flow. And so when all of a sudden, if there's not a busting loose, if there's not this great inspiration, I already know what I need to do. Even if I open up my mouth and it just not is not there, which is an evident description and manifestation of the Holy Ghost speaking. Here's what I'll do. You with me? You ready?
Yeah.
I'll say this. Holy Spirit, I ask you now, come and strengthen me. Huh? Ask you so kind of man depa will just about a nepa to la bahavra. I can't hardly say that. And then we got a 30-minute plus drive. When I cross the threshold, and you'll not see me ever get out of my car not praying in the Holy Ghost. You'll never see it. You'll never see me cross over that threshold of that door with that prabasevetaya. I might stop just in long enough to say hello, bless you, love you, but da-da-da-ba-se-vete-ya-pa. Because what is that? That's a measure of the flow. Now, I watch people all the time. They don't do that. They don't understand that. So then my thing is, how do you measure the flow? How do you allow God, the Holy Ghost, to bring you to that place of availability, to bring you that to that place of yieldedness, to build you up and strengthen you so that the expressions of glory that is all he's going to receive in his house. And the only way the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is going to ever be manifested through you is by that yieldedness. How do you do it? You don't do it. You don't do it. Now, I know the people of old that before Pentecost, I know people right now that are prayer warriors. You could call them prayer warriors because they pray. And vigorously and intensely, you know. They'll go to prayer 3-4 hours before the meeting. They're not filled with the Holy Ghost. But they'll go to prayer. They'll be crying out for everybody, naming everybody, calling them by name, calling out God to do something and break off the yoke, calling every lost family member. And they'll have an expression of the Spirit of the Lord. I can do in 1 minute in the Holy Ghost what took them 4 hours to do. In fact, I believe I'm ahead of them. I'm not kidding. I'm not bragging. I'm just telling you. This is the things of the Spirit that's been given us. If we just understand it and recognize what God has given us, how he's put us on the expedited program, it's expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter cannot come. The comfort, the boldness are great indicators of the flow. I mean, you know, one of the things that I used to have, or really, actually not used to, I still do, but I think I depended upon it more in those days because I didn't have the level of continuous flow, as it were, as I do now. My relationship wasn't as matured with him. But because, and I'd say that loosely, and just understand, we struggle to be able to express things in ways that we can all understand it. Okay? And so, I would just say in my relationship with the Lord, Lord, you my glory and the lifter of my head. And in that relationship with the Lord, Father could see me. He could see I don't have any boldness in my own self. I don't have confidence in myself. I'm the first one to say, raise my hand on vote of no confidence over me. Who of you in the room doesn't believe that Mark can do it? First, I'm not kidding you. I'm not just saying that. That's my heart. And so therefore, in that dimension of it being my heart, Father, see it. I just look at Father and say, Father, you my glory and lifter of my head. I'm totally dependent on you. And then, boom, the anointing come upon me. And of course, you know, one of the things for me where that really began to be highlighted is when I was traveling with different people. And then I'm running, trying to help them take care of stuff. And all I'm doing is kind of just being basically a servant, sitting back. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, hey, come minister. I was standing one night. I mean, we were slap worn out. We were in Medellin, Colombia. And I was with a preacher there. And there was, I don't know, 8,000 to 10,000 people in the meeting. I wasn't even on the platform. I didn't want to be on the platform. I didn't need to be on the platform. I was just happy to be there and be helping out and being used by the Lord and what the Lord had me to do. And, you know, there was, I don't know, five rows of preachers in that 8,000 to 10,000. It was probably more people than that. It was a huge auditorium and it was packed. And the preacher says from the platform, Mark, come here. So I came. Huh? Lord, you my glory and lifted my head. See, that's not at the last minute. Has there been any preparing? Has there been any, you know, all these host preachers, they didn't invite me. I get up there, you're ministering. Okay. Hallelujah. What does that do? What does hallelujah do? It's my flow. Then I'm saying, okay, we've got to stop everything. I got to sing three songs. If we do, I mean, I've seen pastors, preachers do that, where the flow is already there, and they're like, shut everything down and have so-and-so come and sing. And it's like, but you know what? That's what they hook up with. And they got to have that, you know, what did they call them? Virtuosos or whatever? With the operatic voice? You know what I'm saying? Sing for them to hook up, whatever it takes. What does it take for you? What does it take for you? Hallelujah. Pokashte perenashe kotaramambreteya fafateyala. Not much when you do that all day long. Not much when you're willing to be continually filled with the Spirit. And in the language of the Spirit has got to be for us an indication of the flow. It can't just be mutterings. Huh? And I'm going to tell you something else about the flow. Where you start in the language of the Spirit, you shouldn't end up in the language of the Spirit. Understand, listen, when I'm saying this, I know a couple of things. Number one, I know that other preachers are watching this. Holy Ghost preachers, the great anointings in their life. Number two, I know that Christ, which is even bigger for me, I know that Christ Jesus and the Holy Ghost and the Father is listening to me. I'm making sure that I know that what I'm describing to you is very important and it's true and it's accurate. When you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, it shouldn't sound anything like that by the time you're done, even if it was 10 minutes or 5 minutes. And yet I hear people sound like the same thing they were doing, you know, 50 years ago. There's something wrong with that. I'm afraid that may be just a muttering, or you're stuck somehow. You didn't understand how to excel. And you've got to recognize that it's not something that we're trying to get out of you out of performance. We're trying to help you understand how to give yourself to a relationship, hand yourself over to a relationship in the Holy Ghost to where he can develop you. And if you need some adjustment, anybody think they need any adjustment, by the way? Well, good. Because that's why God put adjusters in the church. To adjust things. To say, no, that's not right. I can't believe you're so sensitive. I can't believe you just said that to me. Okay. We got to get out of that stuff because that's what's stopping you. It's that self-absorbed self-defense. It has to do with a dimension of the pride of life. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
If you're going to walk in a flow, you're going to learn how to walk in humility. And it's good for you when somebody says something to you that hurts you. Huh? Because you get to say, self-defense. Humility is just so happy to hear. Huh? Now, if I was somebody that didn't love you, didn't care, or didn't know, knew less than you, and now trying to talk to you, maybe you could be a little bit uppity. Huh? And spread your peacock feathers. And I don't want to say that because I know the peacock is a symbol of Satan, but nonetheless. No, among witchcraft it is. I'm sorry. But nonetheless. It is still the pride of life. And you just have to understand there's things that we've allowed to go on in our life. And, you know, if someone by the Holy Ghost is going to come and try to help you and touch something, you don't have to be all hurt. You don't have to be all defensive. Because if you're going to be hurt and defensive against someone who the Lord said in your life to help you, then you're hurt and defensive against the Holy Ghost. Because hurt and defense is a resistance, isn't it? And that all is a manifestation. You're resisting the Holy Ghost. You don't want to believe that. No one wants to believe that. But that's the way it is. Because the flow is just too easy. Flow is just too easy. The flow of how we praise. So we could actually back out for a minute, if you wanted to, of not even a measurement of the flow of the utterance of the Holy Ghost, but the flow of how you praise. In other words, how deep do you go? How aware are you of it being between you and the Lord? How struck with his presence and awe are you when you begin to worship? Huh? How many, you know, you recognize that sometimes you start worshiping and it's like, huh? Huh? Right? It's like everything's out of key, everything's offbeat. What's the words? This isn't my favorite song. It's too slow, it's too fast, too loud, too soft. Right? I guarantee you if the flow of the Holy Ghost was stronger, you would have never noticed that. Even if it were true, you would have never noticed it. But backing out of that, now you're just looking at, how do I enter in? I got so many distractions. And it could even be like, you know, I feel terrible. Things aren't going right. I probably not even saved. I don't even believe that I'm here tonight. God probably doesn't love me. Even if I was to start singing, no one will hear. I can't sing anyways because I'm usually off key. I don't want to disturb the person beside me because I don't want them to feel as bad as I do. I mean, can you imagine that actually goes on in people's lives? I'm sorry, but it does. With the whole plethora and the whole fullness of the word of other things, a pantheon, and let me go ahead and use the fullness of that word too, of other issues. Are you listening? That's not the flow. Hallelujah. What's going to make the difference? Especially when you know that everybody, well, especially when you know that Father is looking and beholding, and He sets you as a witness before all the nations of the earth, and He's graced you with it and given you something that you can be accountable for. Is it going to be that you can be accountable to Him for that is going to make the difference in the expression in your life? Are you going to be faithful in a few things, some small things? How do you participate? If the preacher's, I don't care where you're at. I don't care where you're at. If the preacher on the front row is sitting down and he stands up, you stand up with him. Yes. Don't sit there. That's like sitting when the bride comes in. Can you hear me? Yes. It's so disrespectful. It's so a description of, I'm not going to participate. You don't do it consciously. You did it subconsciously. It was already in you. It was already there. Sorry to tell you, but it's just the way it is. It's not a guess. It's certainty. It's a place of where you now serve the anointing, where you honor the authority, where you move. I'm going to tell you right now, it's true. I am very careful to make sure that when everybody else is clapping, I'm clapping too. Huh? Now, I know some preachers, I've watched preachers play on the front row, and one say, I'm going to get everybody clapping right now. And everybody starts clapping, but that's fine. And if he wants to play his game, go ahead and play your game. But everybody else did right. You may have done wrong, but everybody else did right. And the guy on the other side goes, watch me. And everybody starts clapping. So they can play their game if they want. It's fine. That's between them and the Lord. Everybody else did what was right. They participated. They didn't know what they were clapping about. But that's all you're called to do. Be a bondservant. I want to be Elijah. I had a guy come to me one time. He said, Pastor, I just want to let you know, the Lord came to me last night and revealed to me that I was an apostle. I didn't smile. I'm smiling right now. I said, man, that's pretty radical. I said, well, why don't you do something for me? He said, what? I said, why don't you be a deacon first? And that was, for me and my thinking, a serious promotion. I mean, I'm talking a serious promotion. Without any other inspiration, I would have never said that. It would have been like, man, you're still a long ways out from a deacon right now. Because, I mean, I take the Bible serious. I understand what a deacon's supposed to be. And he ain't meeting the qualifications yet. And so, maybe I've been too stringent with the qualifications. No. Anybody think I've been too stringent with the qualifications? Well, the response to that is, is it what the Word of God says? Okay, so, okay, well, I'll leave you alone. I don't bother you too much. And I'm telling you right now, he's never been in the church since. He became so irate and just I can't even believe that I would be so indignant and disrespectful. Look, I mean, if God's going to say you're an apostle, he's got to let a couple of them. He's got to let a couple of the rest of us know, too. I mean, you know, that's a big step up from where you're at. Not participating, not serving. What are you hungry for? I mean, if you're hungry for the things of God, you're earnest to do whatever it takes. You're looking for an opportunity. You're reading the Word saying, okay, Father, whatever you want me to do. No job's too small. Whatever you want me to do. You know, I started saying to you by the Holy Ghost Sunday night, the Lord's laid a hold on you that you may lay hold on Him. Are you listening to me? Yes. And I know I got pretty radical. God, you got to use me. But, it was really, the point was, the desire was to make a point that you can begin to become bold with God. If you're participating with Him, if you're obeying Him, if you're going after those things that He said in the Word, it's more for you than it is for Him. Yes. The flow. Yes. The flow is so full of boldness. It's so full of confidence. is so full of the manifestation of the presence of the Lord, the sweet presence of Jesus, the overwhelming glory of the Holy Ghost taking us, sweeping us off of our feet, the flow. And then, one of the beautiful things about the flow is the Lord will come and interrupt us with the depth of the flow that we've never experienced. And then not only that, he'll just come and he'll interrupt us with the things that we're not even expecting. I love to get interrupted like I was about two Sundays ago when I couldn't even sing. I was so overwhelmed with the presence of God, I couldn't. It was just so deep and so wonderful. I just love that depth of his presence, of his glory. Hey, I love the new song flowing out. I love walking in as we did on Sunday and hearing someone singing in the Spirit, Ruthanna singing in the Spirit, and then just have right there the interpretation of it in the new song. All of those things. But I want it for you as well. I want you to have that. I want to help move you from your self-consciousness, your sense of not being qualified, your sense of not being able, not knowing how. Well, I would do it, but I'm just afraid I'm going to be wrong. No, I'm talking about having a flow where that isn't even in the universe. That's not even in your universe. I would do it, but I'm so afraid of getting corrected. You got yourself a problem. Because the flow I'm talking about, that's not even in the same universe. That thought's not even in the same universe. It don't even exist in this universe. Well, I really had something, but I didn't think it was the appropriate time. Once again, it's not even in the same universe. It doesn't even exist in this realm. I want you to get in the flow where it becomes God. And you're so overwhelmed by his presence. You're so overwhelmed by his. It's called unction. Yes. In the translation of certain dimensions of the anointing. It's an unction. It is something that compels you. It grabs a hold of you. It's like fire shut up in your bones. Have you ever had that? You might have a fire in your bones. I was in a hospital one night. I heard a woman screaming, "My bones!" She's having a baby. It's pretty rude. She's screaming, "My bones!" It's like, am I supposed to be hearing this? My bones. Yeah, it's like fire shut up in your bones. You're not going to be thinking, "Hey, I'm not sure if it's the right time." I was concerned I might be corrected or sit down or what. It's my bones. I mean, it's exploding. It's like, it's your word. It's like a fire. Shut up in my bones. You can just contain it for so long. And that's the flow. It's like, come on, man. How long can you keep your mouth shut when there's a river behind it? Yeah? And it's not just a river, it's rivers. There's a shout. Huh? There's a place where you move out of the intellectual, let me string together a couple of thoughts. Well, you can string yourself a couple of thoughts together when you first starting out. Baby steps for baby or whatever. But then go, you leave that. You leave that to a place of just praise, being alone with him in a public place, a flow that you're just so confident that the Spirit of the Son speaking in you, through you, the Spirit of the Father speaking in you, the Spirit of the Holy Ghost speaking through you. It's not your words, but his words. Then you don't have to go sit down and go, "Oh, did I make any sense? Oh, I just feel like I totally messed up. Oh, I just feel like I had my opportunity and I was just a loser. I was just a blow it." That's what's keeping you from flowing right there. That thing needs to be dealt with in your thinking. That thing, how long's that been in there anyways? That's a stinking mess. You've been going to bed with that at night? You've been living with that unholy thing, that harassing, tormenting demon, as it were. It's about time you get yourself a sword. go to cleaning the house. Are you listening to me? The flow, man, needs no apologies. Huh? The flow needs no human strength. Doesn't rely upon human ability. Brings with it a great comfort, a great boldness. You feel like you grow 40 feet tall. Great confidence, a great certainty, a great joy, a great glory. Grows and excels into where that you begin to have open visions, where you begin to have discerning of spirits, and it's very accurate. It's very, you're very clear on it. Not to say that you're accurate 100% of the time. No one is. Huh? Not yet. We're going there. That 100% of the time, everybody you pray gets healed for. Every prayer you pray for gets healed, but we're going there. Hallelujah. That every word is just perfect like God himself would say. Say it. No, but it's close. Hallelujah. The primary intent is there. And I don't even consider it. And in the realms of the spirit, in the realm of the flow, you're not getting a report card. You're not getting your paper handed back to you with a grade on it. You got 65% tonight. It's none. The Lord accepts it. He inspires it, produces in our lives, and he accepts it as an offering. Jesus, be glorified in everything I say. I love that as a word from heaven, out of the Spirit, from tongues. Jesus, be glorified in everything I do. Jesus, be glorified in this offering that I bring. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Be revealed in your congregation. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Name above all names. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. The flow. What is the flow? It's that interaction between you and him. It's that interaction that exists between you and the Lord Jesus, that the Holy Ghost is supplying all of the impacts, all of the revelation, all of the inspiration, all of the ability, all of the insight. Hallelujah. We want that for you. I want tongues of interpretation in your life now, not tomorrow, now. I want tongues that I can bring you into a room and help you with. And you sit down and you start praying in tongues, and I don't want you to be thinking about, oh, pastors, listen to me. I'm going to have to come up with a job instead of a la, 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 la. Because that ain't going to do any, because a job instead of the la, 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 la is going to sound exactly the same. Because he's the one in here, he's wanting to help me out, listening to the shift and just pray along with me. Because I wouldn't be pointing out like you're singing harmony in a quartet. No, go down low here. Now, right there. You missed it right there. No, I would just start batting. I'd start praying along with you because it has to be caught. But you can't be caught unless you want it, unless you're hungry for it. I want you to be able to, I told people a long time ago, and everyone who heard me and did it, they prospered from it. Everybody who didn't think they needed to do it, didn't change. Go home. Hit a recorder, listen to yourself praying the Holy Ghost. Then do it again later. How much change is there in it? Is there a development going on? Is there a growth? You get on a scale and weigh yourself. You interested in your body? Huh? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
There's a lot, because the Father's looking and he's listening. And he sees where we measure our importance, what we value in our life. Are you measuring the most important things in your life? Are you valuing the most important things in your life, the things of heaven? In other words, are you hungering and thirsting after righteousness? Are you seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness? That's the big question that you have to say. And I'm sure that most everybody in here tonight, you can say yes. To some degree, yes. But if you would just go ahead and allow these things to become more in your life, you're going to get a big benefit from it. You're going to prosper from it. God's a rewarder. You're going to grow. You're going to find, wait a minute, now this flow of diverse tongues is coming. Now, wow, the way, same way that tongues come, so is the interpretation, the same kind of overwhelming inspiration. I just hear it. For me, I can almost hear it on it. Sometimes a guitar for me is that way. When Joshua was playing the guitar on Wednesday night, I turned to him. I said, I hear the song in that. Because he's praying on the anointing, and sometimes those notes will become almost like tongues to me. I can hear the words. Somebody said, wow, that's an amazing mind. You can hear the words. Word for word for word, sentence for sentence. No, I hear the inspiration of the words. It's flow. If you got my attention and said, stop and tell me what the words are, I may not be able to. But if I just went with the inspiration, I just started opening my mouth and singing, they would just come out. Hallelujah. And the same thing happens in Namaserete Namasapahali. I can hear the words. I can hear the words. I can hear the words to it. I just hear the words to it. It's an inspiration. But the sometimes I hear them actually when Ruthiana was singing in the Holy Ghost. Was it on Sunday morning? I actually heard the words. She started singing something, and that's fine. But I already heard the words to what she was saying in tongues. I heard them. I could have actually told you what the words, I could have told you at least the start of it, the first couple of phrases. I can remember in the flow, because I was zealous for spiritual gifts. Are you zealous tonight? Are you zealous? Because that's a big part of the flow. Five of you, praise God. I'm glad the rest of you came. Just join in, just look and see. Everything you do is something of a manifestation. We don't want to believe it. Well, I just didn't raise my hand because I just thought you knew anyways. I didn't tell you I love you because I figured you already knew that. Or on and on I could go. My arm's sore. I didn't know we were supposed to raise hands. If we really believed it. And on and on and on and on. But it's all a manifestation. It really is. We don't want to believe that about ourselves, but start believing it. Because then you're going to have some measurable change. You're going to start looking at yourself going, hey, what is it? McFly, wake up. Whatever. Whatever it is, right? Right. Hey, Spitzbergen, hello. Lights are on, but no one's home. Wake up. Participate. Get in with the program. Zealous, covetous spiritual gifts. Oh, that creates within our life a yieldedness, a desire. It makes room for us to be able to now hear things God say we wouldn't have been able to hear. I guarantee you, if you are not zealous and desperate, you will not hear God speaking what otherwise would be very clear to you if you were. It's a spiritual state of being. You decide. You can resist it. You can say it's not so. I don't agree with it. But you got to disagree with the Bible. And then if you say, I'm not saying I disagree with the Bible. I disagree with you. Well, then you're going to have to disagree with your lack of manifestation in your life then. Because unfortunately, when we're trying to help people, we run up with this pride of life thing over and again. This hard-headed thing, stubborn thing over and again. And we don't want to. We just want you to say, is that all I needed to do? Yes, it's okay. And how profit? How much? What am I going to get? Like, what am I? What'd you say I was going to make on this? Like 10,000? Yeah. You're done. You're on your way. Right? Wait. How about if I now measure it in spiritual terms? And now you're really excited about it. And now it's so meaningful for you. You're telling me that that's all I need to do. All I need to do is to give myself to these things. If I brought you up here right now and I held a microphone in your front of you and I'd say, I want you to give me the four major points that I've given tonight, just four out of the 20, four major points that I give tonight on yieldedness to the Lord, what would be coming out of your mouth? What would you be saying? If you've got a hungry heart, if you've got a desperate heart for the Lord, you're wanting to have these things, and you're making what God is saying valuable, you're going to get all of them right. Because even if you can't remember them, and you're trying to think of them, it's just going to be big on the inside of you. You really do remember everything you're extremely interested in. Basically, you remember that. You have an amazing mind if you're really interested in it and you really want it. It's a beautiful thing. The Lord wants you to step right over into tongues, interpretation tongues. He wants you to step right over into prophecy, to where the song just goes to another level. Am I blessed by what's going on in your lives in this church? Oh, I absolutely am. I'm here tonight wanting to present to you an opportunity to learn how to flow in a deeper way so that you begin to be prepared by the Lord to be used in a greater way, to be able to speak on His behalf, to be able to lay hands on the sick and they recover, to be able to just have that flow and be so confident and so comfortable in His presence. And all of a sudden you stand in front of somebody or get near someone and there's all of a sudden you know all these things about them. The flow is just activated on the inside of you and it just bursts on the inside of you. And you just start talking to them right out of that realm. And watch how people's lives get impacted and get changed by the Holy Ghost being able to have free course through your lives. The flow. It all comes back right to the very place, number one, of your relationship with Him and how that's developed. And recognizing this beauty, this sense of confidence and boldness and certainty and rest and peace and all the other good things that are there when you're in it. Amen. So, you have to decide whether or not you're going to be able to have the time to develop these things in your life.
Yes.
How many of you, and I want everybody to participate on this. Jesus. How many of you, when you begin to worship the Lord, you just completely go to another place? You're isolated from everything that is around you. Just raise your hand. Okay. How many of you that doesn't happen? Anybody? How many does that happen to every time? Every time you go to a private, secret place with the Lord. Good. How many at the end of the process of worship, you're there? Just, how many of you, not every time. So right there you have something to measure. I want you to know that a personal relationship with your personal relationship development of just saying, look, I'm going to learn how to start flowing in the Holy Ghost more. I'm going to learn to have a flow that is a measurable flow of the Holy Ghost before I walk into the meeting in my life will ultimately take you to where the sin is the first note is struck. you're there. Can there be hindrances? Can there be hindrances in a meeting? Yeah, but I guarantee I'm busted wide open.
Yeah.
So it won't be a hindrance. I tell you right now, let me just put it to you this way. For me, if that first note doesn't result in just going away, I'm just gone, for me, it's a hindering spirit. And it ain't coming out against me. It's in the place. I'll bust the thing. I will smack it till it's gone. I'll smack it till it's gone. I will not sit by and let that continue on. Somebody said, how do you do that? I sing louder, more radical. Sometimes I'll just begin to pray radically in the Holy Ghost. I'm not going to sit back and let that go on. Don't you sit back and let that go on. Because it has nothing to do with, so to speak, with something that God is not releasing to you or that you don't have with you. Huh? It has nothing to do with a fixed structure within your environment that says you can't do this here. Like prison, midnight, Silas and Paul. Understand?
Yes.
Sometimes you just have to close your eyes. I rarely have to close my eyes. But sometimes you have to close your eyes. Maybe there's things going on that is distracting you. You need to close your eyes. Get into the flow. It's about getting in the flow. You're not going to do anything in the anointing if you don't get into the flow. Amen. Does anybody have any questions you want to ask me about this one? Because I mean, I can talk about this all night and just try to, while I'm doing it, try to personally sit down in various different people's lives and say, okay, this is what's going on. I mean, you could ask me, you could say, well, you know, you could ask a question. You say, you know what? I think I have exactly the same tongue that I had since the very beginning. I don't really even notice any transitions in it or any changes in it. Can you help me? When you begin to expose yourself that way, with transparency, you begin to look for help. Guess who hears that? God. Guess what works on the side of your spirit? Humility. Teachability. What's that result in? Yieldedness. I mean, even almost by the very moment of asking about it, change takes place. And nobody's hiding anyways. We know exactly who you are and what you got. I could write it on a piece of paper right now and get it verified and witnessed by other people who observe you. And if you would be really very honest, painfully honest, you'd have to say yes to. You might have to go take it home and pray about it for a month, but you'd come to the conclusion, yeah, that's right. I mean, it's just, we've all been there. Look, we just, you know, I look at a huge church, a huge population of God's people. And you should be able to as well. And the numbers of the people that are moving things forward and advancing things are very few. Then we have to say, why is that? When the Lord has given to every, excuse me, every one of us the same opportunities in the Spirit. Yeah.
So you're saying that if we never pray in tongues, it changes. Why does it happen when I'm praying for people for healing and when I'm praying for myself? It's different.
No, my question was that my presentation of a question was. You could just ask anything. You could say that this is what's going on. If you're saying that when you are praying in the Holy Ghost, it just always sounds the same. I say, I'm telling you right now, that isn't what the Lord wants. He wants that to develop. It should start someplace and end up in an entirely different place. It should excel. And it should ultimately excel beyond just the tongues. It should, because it should be praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in the Spirit, and praying in the understanding also, but by the same Holy Ghost. And it's, you could almost think it's like interpretation of tongues, but it's not. It's riding on the inspiration. So what are you asking me? Maybe I didn't hear you. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I think that I have no problem with that. That's fine and everything. I think that the issue that I want to bring out is that it should be diverse. It should be multi-expressional. It should be something that is strengthened, it's developed, it becomes stronger in you, it becomes stronger through you. It carries with it not just an activity of your tongue, but literally sweeps all of your emotions and your passions into it, to where it could actually result in you losing, as it were, the English language. It could result in an uncontrollable laughter, an overwhelming love, a revelation from heaven, an open vision, a prophecy, a miracle, but bigger than all of that, an interaction with the Lord in such a way to where that His presence becomes more strongly manifested to you than it was when you started. Because it really is the teacher at work with us, taking us, developing us to be able to more perfectly interact with Him and participate with what's going on in heaven. Tongues cannot just remain some simple expression that's not changed. It's by virtue of what it does and what God's doing through it and what happens in our life, it develops, it becomes strong, powerful. And once again, I had every one of you raise your hands a little bit ago, and you recognize that that's what happens. At least most of you do, I think, right? Yeah. Is there anybody that doesn't recognize that? Have I spoken on behalf of someone here in the place that doesn't recognize that? If you said to the Lord right now, if you asked the Lord, if you had an opportunity to ask the Lord, Lord, what do I need to do to develop more in the gifting of the Spirit? This and manifestation of the Holy Ghost, what would that question be? 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 What would it be? What would it be? What would it be? What would it be? What would the question be to the Lord? If you could ask Him a question, say, Lord, what do I need to do in order to be more developed in the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, for these things to mature in my life, to be more yielded to You, to flow in a deeper way. What would that question be? And really, those kinds of questions should be a part of your prayer life. You want to if you want to follow me, I'll tell you what I do. I'll talk in detail with the Lord about it. Sometimes I'll lay in bed and not go to sleep for a long time saying, okay, now Lord, what do I need to do? Okay, I see that. And here's what I see. And I describe it to Him. Okay, I just saw very specifically certain things. Like they were on a movie, like they were actually on a movie screen. That clear as I'm looking at you right now. Okay, I see that. That's radical, Lord. That is amazing. Now, what do I do with it? Help me to understand. Take me to the next screen. And then I don't let up. Because I may not hear anything. I said, now, Lord, I want to move forward with you in this. I know that this is your will. I know that these are the things that you have for us. And I want you to be able to freely move in my life. Speak to me whatever you want to say. I'll change whatever I need to change. Just do that. So that's why I say, what's your question you're going to ask him? About the flow. What question would you ask? Want me to give you a good one? Lord, teach me how to flow better.
Yeah.
Maybe you actually have to start. Lord, teach me how to even recognize the flow because I've been operating in whatever mode. Is there anyone here you're not sure about the transition from just something that would be classified as normal and common versus the flow? Do people. Okay. So you know when you're laughing and getting all caught away because you start feeling his presence? That's flow. Okay. Before it was not the flow. Now that's, you know, it's like me saying to the preachers, okay, all you guys just start flowing the Holy Ghost right now. Let's just go pray because I'm been brought LA talking to a whole church full of preachers from Asia. They're all looking at me like, because they have been trained and they've trained themselves, basically start flowing in the Holy Ghost at the altar call at the end of the meeting or at certain particular points in worship, and we're not worshiping. Because I just took the meeting just like this. I came in, they're all sitting there, no worship, no nothing. Hello, okay, everybody start praying in the Holy Ghost. Why did I say that? Lord inspired me to say it. What was revealed out of it? That they didn't know how to do that. And they're all baptized in the Holy Ghost. You mean you're trying to tell us that you can pray in the Holy Ghost whenever you want? Because the scripture says that they all spake with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. I said, yes. Now, I just said yes to two questions, right? Yeah. Well, what do you mean? I mean that the Holy Ghost is always flowing. He's always expressing. You're not always hooked up. So what you're going to have to do is stop waiting for those certain moments. Certain people, they'll hear a certain song. They get to a certain point in a certain song, and they'll start crying. Or a certain point in a certain song, and it's inspirational to them. And they go to shouting, whoa, whoa. I mean, and it's real. It's real. It's an inspiration. But it's like locked in to just a certain set of conditions. It has not invaded every dimension of their life yet. And so we're just saying, God wants to invade every dimension of your life. You just got to participate with them. Hallelujah. And you don't, in a place like that, all these guys are older. You think they're going to respond to the Holy Ghost? You know what's hindering them? What they know, their experience, what they've practiced, what they believe, how they're used to yielding, how they're used to flowing. The flow should be continuous, which should be the other way. It should actually be flipped around. In other words, don't put out the flame of the Holy Ghost. Quench not the Spirit instead of trying to get the pilot light working. Here's the preacher. He's down there. You can see him up there. Here he is. Every meeting, here he is. And everybody's going, what on earth is he doing? He's trying to get the pilot light lit. spiritually. Hallelujah. It looks like that in some respects. It's awkward. Lord, teach me how to flow more. I want to learn how to flow. That's why Jude said, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourself in the love of God and expression in the Holy Ghost. Every dimension of joy, love, peace, all the good things of heaven, all expressions of the Holy Ghost, God's willing to give it to us and give it to us in full dimensions of it. And we're receiving and functioning in as much as we're yielded to. Love, joy, peace. What happens when joy and love and peace becomes an indicator to you? You go back to the bedroom. Excuse me. This thing's getting down in my throat. It's working its way out right now. Just about out. Hallelujah. See, things like that may come on you, like that I described as a frog in my throat, but it doesn't belong to me. It's not mine. It's an invader. It is a foreign invader treading upon this holy and hallowed and sacred ground. Some people sit around and try to think it through and figure it out. And, oh, what did I do wrong? What's going on? Don't do that. That's just going to keep you from the flow, man. The best way to get into the flow is just to live in the love of God and the love the Father has for you. If there's any prayer that I pray, is, Lord, strengthen me. Teach me how to walk in a greater humility before you. Walk humbly with your God. He's God, you're not. He's in charge. Do what he said to do. He said, you know, desire spiritual gifts. And that you also may prophesy. I mean, think about it. When was the last time you prophesied and obeyed God? Just ask it. When's the last time you prophesied? You should look at me and say, on the way here. I just prophesy in my car. My goodness, I just feel, and that's great. That's fine. No, we want you to make your transition. Huh? You should be prophesying every time you go to prayer. And if you're not, you're missing out on all the fun. No wonder. My goodness, if you're bummed out and looking weird, no wonder, man. Huh? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You, right? You're a penguin in Florida. Come on, get over here. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. This is where the fun's at. I hope you understand the flow, how to step into the flow. It's so easy, but it's got to be on the basis of your relationship. It's got to work out within your life a dependency. I told the Lord one time in my life, I said, Lord, if I don't feel the flow, if I don't feel the anointing, I will not open my mouth and speak without your inspiration. I was invited to preach in a church. And I got up to preach, and it was soon after that. I got up to preach. There was a no flow, no anointing, no inspiration. And I went and sat back down. Now, I'd been preaching for a number of years. I'd been preaching for at least 5 or 6 years. But I'm going to tell you right now, it never happened again. I really just believe that the Lord was evaluating my heart. Really? You really want to do that? I'd say to the Lord, Lord, I want to so be dependent upon the flow. Let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth as it did in Ezekiel's life. And then all of a sudden things are going to be being worked out in your life. But let me just say this. You don't have to do all that. It's just recognizing that the flow was there, learning how to give yourself to the flow, and being willing not to do anything without the flow. And if the flow's not, if you start and the flow's not there, just and it's time for you to share or to do some ministry, say, everybody, let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Let's just pray. Let's just, everybody pray with me. Or sing another song. And then as you begin to do that, then you'll recognize that there's things that you can participate with God in that just allows you to go that much deeper. Amen. So I hope you understand more than what you did when we got started. And I hope that you would just give yourself to having that measurable flow of the Holy Ghost when you cross the threshold of coming into the house of the Lord. You're ready. You come up with singing. Praise is already there. Amen. Well, thank you, Lord Jesus. Sutaraba bakaseteya. Turinambo jese keta. Lembem brudate. Lembre da se pruna. Lembrando se keste. Lambam de defeto. Zeterinamase. Hare befrete canamos. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ibrebeda kashomburo bositi ferabasatata lalana mamanea. Bengando rosso prevetisha batalo monobatea. Hallelujah. Sikam breveti candolo bose prebe biandara la mossa prata vai. Sutendere vecchi prebassata la la mangesse sia tusto. Beam rabacata la. Now, you know what? If I keep doing this, you know what's going to happen? It's going to get louder, isn't it? It's going to get more intense, isn't it? It's going to have a diverse expression in tonality, in sound, in syllable, if you would, in passion. And then that's going to go somewhere too. Do that. Just start doing that. Do that at home. Do that riding in the car. Start doing it in the meeting. Watch what happens. Okay, do we have a meeting? Do we have a meeting tonight after this for children's ministry? Are we guys just gonna? Everybody, stand with me. And then we're gonna. Everybody who's here for who's part of children's ministry, I want to meet with you in just a minute. Lift your hands towards heaven. Feel a change.
Yeah.
Just feel a change. There you go. Now you worship the Lord out of that change. Amen. Now just flow. Now you just step out in confidence. If you don't move from there into self-consciousness and then try to get back into the flow. When you get in the flow, don't step out. Whatever you got to do, don't step out. Stay with the flow. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What does my brain do when I'm praying in the Holy Spirit?
No idea.
What should it do?
Well, what do you mean by brain? You mean by thoughts?
Yes, my thoughts.
Thoughts pretty much shut down?
No thoughts.
Pretty much they just shut down. I mean, that's a good question. Dwayne said, what do I do with my brain while I'm praying in the Holy Ghost? So I said, well, what do you mean by your brain? And I said, you mean your thoughts? And he said, yeah. Your thoughts should just shut down. It's a beautiful thing about praying in the Holy Ghost. We learn how to actually have governance and control over every thought that enters our head. Huh? Literally. Where you're not having to be bombarded with all these kinds of images and thoughts and thinking. You've got total mastery over every thought. Father will develop you there. You don't have to feel like you're not saved if you don't have that. Because I'm talking about growth and maturity. But what you would want to do is to say, I want that. Go after the growth and maturity, and then that way you can have that. Really, it's such a realm of peace, is really. It's why there really isn't much realm of thought. It's I think that the greater dimension of where we step over into the realms of participating with the anointing that we received and the moving of the Holy Ghost in our life. It's like the peace is so overwhelming, you think about nothing. I mean, I was really blessed one night hearing a number of different, I was actually with Rodney, and he was just standing on the platform for a considerable amount of time, just standing there doing nothing, and it was quite a sight to see in the building. But I mean, he just made a statement. He said, people wonder what I'm thinking about. He said, I'm honestly, there's not a single thought that goes through my mind. It's just overwhelming peace. And it's, yeah, that's what it is. It's exactly what it is. The peace that Father has given to us that passes understanding is such a beautiful thing to participate with. It is terrible. God's people don't know how to step into that and participate with it. And so we're here to help you. We're here to help you do that. We're here to show you. Just moving this, just moving the things we're describing to you, that I described to you tonight. Start doing them. Watch what happens. Amen. Let me meet with everybody. You guys hug one another. Tell each other that you love each other.